Orion presents The Dark by Sharon Bolton, read by Lisa Coleman. A letter to my readers. Welcome, dear reader, and thank you for choosing The Dark from the millions of books on sale today. I'm honoured, not to mention pleased as punch. As all good authors should, I write the sort of books that I love to read myself. Tense and twisty tales of dark deeds, peopled by characters who are compelling but deeply flawed. Stories full of passion and intrigue, when lives are frequently on the line and the narrative flows at breakneck pace. I write in the Gothic tradition that I love, packing my books with chills, thrills, and tons of creepy atmosphere. Given this, you might imagine I live alone in a ruined Scottish castle, scribbling through the night in candlelit rooms, wandering the windswept hills by day in pursuit of the muse. Nothing so glam, I'm afraid. In reality, I'm a middle-aged mum in the home counties, although the famous Midsummer Murders is filmed in our village, so there may be something in the water after all. I live with my lurcher dog Lupe, my husband, and occasionally our university-aged son. My passions, apart from family and stories, are wild swimming and sailing, and I enjoy nothing more than a cosy dinner with friends and lashings of cold white wine. If you're new to the Lacey Flint stories, I hope you love her as much as I do. And if you'd like to stay in touch in between books, then please sign up to my newsletter or find me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. www.sharonbolton.com. And now it's time. Take a deep breath, tread carefully, but most of all, enjoy your walk on the dark side. Prologue. A few hours after midnight, two young women sat in a car close to the edge of a cliff. One of them was dead, the other merely felt that way. The spot they'd arrived at, leaving the road to drive the final yards over rough heathland, was the highest of Britain's chalk cliffs. It was also one of the most notorious suicide spots in the world, with cautious estimates giving it responsibility for a little short of 500 deaths since the early 1960s. The woman, whose heart was technically still beating, wondered if two more might be enough to make the nice, round, half-millennial. She switched off the ignition, let the sounds of the engine cooling fade into the night, and opened the door to say goodbye to the world. Held tight by her seatbelt, her companion's eyes were closed, but as air flooded into the car, her hair blew across her face, giving it, for a second, the illusion of life continuing. A cruel trick. The woman, clinging to life for a few minutes more, closed the car door and saw with relief the interior slip into darkness. Driving the 80 miles from South London, with nothing but her own thoughts and the recriminations of a corpse beside her, had been harder than she'd expected. Leaving the car, she stepped towards the black void that she knew was the cliff edge. The night was cool for September, a light breeze blowing in from the west. Coming almost directly from the Isle of Wight, it brought with it hints of the previous day's fish catch, early autumn fires, ripe fruit falling from overladen trees. Then again, she'd always had an active imagination. The smell might be nothing more than the salt stench of the beach, 160 metres below. It would be a grim beach. It had embraced too many broken and battered bodies, absorbed too much blood of the dying to be anything other. It was too late now, far too late, but there had to be better, sweeter places to die. As the young woman's eyes grew used to the darkness, she could see the silver-white line of the chalk cliffs stretching west, and the flicker of the lighthouse in the bay. The moon was a little over half full, misshapen, oddly unsatisfying in its incompleteness, but bright as a polished coin, gently illuminating the clouds. The stars were tiny, flickering, like fairy lights about to run out of battery. The ocean, endless blackness, vast solid sheen that gleamed as though its dark light were coming from its depths. It was a silent ocean, robbed of voice. The waves neither crashing nor grumbling, let alone thundering against rocks. The pain of too much loss weighed the young woman down as she approached the cliff edge, expanding in her chest like rising dough, filling all the available space, so that even breathing was becoming hard. At the same time, the wind stung her eyes, forcing tears she'd been unable to shed until now. Tears were for bearable pain, for lighter sorrows. This pain couldn't possibly be released by tiny drops of water. It would burst forth when it came, exploding her skin, flesh and bones apart like shrapnel. It would get some help, of course, from the rocks below. At least then it would end. When the figure emerged from the darkness, she thought her dead friend, grown impatient, had summoned the unnatural strength to walk herself to her grave. Her cry of alarm broke upon the wind. Not her friend, a stranger, but one drawn with the same grim purpose.
"You can't stop me."
The boy was tense, quivering, like a runner on the brink of the race of his life. He too was feet from the edge. Were he to sprint forward, the momentum would take him over.
"Okay," she said.
He was about her age, late teens, although it was hard to tell in the meagre light. Shorter than she, he was thin at the shoulder, thicker around the waist, and he was panting, as though the walk here, there had been no other vehicles in the car park, had been hard work. Or maybe he'd been crying. His face was blotchy, streaked with mud in the half light. He must have been sitting close to the edge, half hidden among the grass. Must have jumped to his feet at her approach.
"It's my choice," he said, still poised to sprint. "My life."
"Fair enough." His clothes, damp from recent rain, smelled fresh and looked clean. They were newish. His trainers weren't cheap, and his dark hair had been well cut not too long ago.
"You're one of them, aren't you?"
He looked frantically around, as though others, her fictional co-conspirators, might be sneaking up on him.
"The people who tried to stop us."
She sighed. "I'm not going to stop you."
"This forum I'm in, it warned me there'd be people like you. It said to come between 2 and 6 in the morning, that I'd be least likely to come across someone then."
His breath was ragged, his voice catching. She felt a moment of deep annoyance, that her final moments weren't to be peaceful, that her thoughts would be dragged from her by this needy teenager, who probably hadn't faced a real trouble in his short, spoiled life. But that was unkind. And she didn't want to be unkind. Not in the last minutes of her life.
"Your mate in the car."
He was pointing back, as though she might have forgotten where it was.
"Is she phoning this in? Is she calling for, what do you call it, backup?"
The laugh, short and bitter though it was, surprised her. Laughing felt like something she'd closed a final door upon. She said,
"Doubt it."
He took a step closer to the cliff.
"Don't come near me,"
he called, shrill as a startled old lady.
"Not planning to."
She didn't want to be unkind, but this was getting tiresome. And besides, sooner or later, someone else would come along. A patrol car, The Samaritans, an insomniac, do-gooder. She didn't have forever.
It's a big cliff top. I won't get in your way if you don't get in mine.
Stepping closer to the edge, she looked down. She'd never been afraid of heights, but a wave of nausea swept over her. For a moment, it seemed that the ground beneath her feet was moving. Chalk was far from stable. Its cliffs crumbled all the time. She bounced. Nothing gave. And she felt a stab of disappointment. How much easier it would have been to have the moment taken from her.
You serious? The boy said.
Possibly more than he. She wondered how long he'd been here, pondering his woes, kidding himself he was going to jump.
You're not from the, what do you call it, the Coast Guard, or those Samaritan people.
I'm here to go over the edge, same as you.
You're lying. It's a trick. Some reverse psychology bollocks. Make me think you don't care, so that I start to.
Is it working?
No.
Damn, she muttered. I'm losing my touch. Silence. Then,
I'm Nick.
He sounded hesitant, unsure of his own name. She said, I didn't ask.
I left a note for my mum and dad.
I'm sure that'll make all the difference. A moment of just wind and, yes, now she could hear the waves below.
Are you for real? He said. You're actually going to jump?
Technically, I'm going to drive. Put my foot down and soar into oblivion, like Thelma and Louise over the Grand Canyon.
What?
He'd missed the pop culture reference. It doesn't matter. So long, Nick. Have a good death.
Wait!
He called out to her before she'd walked half the distance to the car. She turned and knew that that, in itself, should be telling her something. She could still be called back.
It will be instant, won't it? Death, I mean. I won't know anything about it.
Sighing, she joined him once more on the cliff edge. Instant deaths aren't that common, she said. Decapitation will probably do it. An explosion, maybe. Otherwise, it takes time for the body to shut down. So no, it won't be instant. Quick, but not instant.
How quick?
She pretended to think about it, although she'd thought of little else on the drive down here. Seconds, if you're lucky. Your bones will break on the rocks. Parts of your skull will go into your brain, and there'll be no coming back from that. A couple of your rib bones might go into your heart, and it'll bleed out. Your lungs might get ripped apart too, again by your own bones, making it impossible to breathe. She saw him shudder. If you're not lucky, your essential organs won't be too badly damaged. You'll be stuck on the beach for hours, probably paralysed in a shedload of pain, waiting to bleed out, or for your heart to give up. Still, what do I know? It's not like I've done this before.
You are one of them counsellor types. You're trying to frighten me out of it.
Enough. She took a half step towards him.
Do you want to push?
His eyes opened wide in alarm.
What?
I'll push you if you want. Say the word. He backed away, hands warding her off.
Stay away from me.
Your call. She needed to get to the car, to get it over with. But something held her back.
The impact won't be the worst, she said. The worst would be the moment you jump, when you're in free fall. You'll regret it then. Or give anything to be back up on solid ground, even with all the pain you're going through. But it'll be too late.
If you think that, why are you doing it? He glanced back at the car.
Is it some sort of suicide pact, you and that other girl?
A fresh wave of pain. She's already dead. She died a few hours ago. Drug overdose.
Was she, what, your girlfriend?
Nope.
just the only friend I had left. I'm sorry. He looked it, too. Thank you. Seconds ticked by. So why are you here? The young woman asked. He didn't reply. Girlfriend break up with you? I've never had a girlfriend. His voice was ugly with resentment. Girls don't date guys who look like me. Curious, in spite of herself, she took another look at him. Really looking this time. He was short, and the weight around his girth would sit better on his shoulders and upper arms, but there was nothing a decent diet and a few months of exercise wouldn't put right. His nose was a little hooked, and his eyes rather deep-set, giving him a hawk-like look. But his hair was a glossy dark brown, and his lips full and well-shaped. His worst feature was bad acne, covering the lower part of his face and breaking out on his cheeks and forehead, but time and the right medication would sort that out. No scars, no disfiguring birthmarks. She opened her mouth to utter some platitude about his looks and decided she couldn't be bothered.
Would you?
He asked, reluctant to let it go. You hitting on me?
Girls who look like you aren't interested in boys like me, he went on. Even the ugly girls go after the good-looking ones. Guys like me don't stand a chance.
He wanted her to argue, to tell him he was wrong, that plenty of girls would find him attractive. Half of her wanted to, if only so he would leave her in peace. But she was so very weary. More than anything, she wanted to sleep. The problem with sleep, though, was that it always came to an end. When you slept, you woke. From the kind of sleep she had in mind, there was no waking up.
You wouldn't, would you? You wouldn't go out with me?
No, she said truthfully. Do you want to come with us?
What?
I'm getting in the car now. I'm going to drive over the edge. I don't think you'll ever have the courage to do it by yourself, but if you get in the back seat, I'll take you with us. She was on her way back to the car, and this time she wasn't stopping. She called over her shoulder.
Last chance. Just don't get in our way, because I won't stop. I'm coming.
He caught up as she reached the car.
Sure?
She said. He looked on the verge of being sick, but he nodded. She opened the car door. That side, she told him. I don't want you grabbing hold of me when we go over.
Nice car, he said, as he got in behind the front passenger seat. Stolen.
She locked the doors and turned on the engine, testing the accelerator, although she already knew the car drove perfectly. Her hand was on the brake, ready to release it.
Shit!
He touched the woman in the front passenger seat.
She's really dead. This is sick. She's actually dead. You thought I was lying to you?
He was pulling at the car door, unable to deactivate the child lock in the back seat.
I thought it was a trick, that the two of you were part of that Coast Guard service, that you drive me back down to Eastbourne.
Bad call. Releasing the handbrake, she held the car on the clutch. A fraction of movement in her left foot, and it would shoot forward. She had already seen that the ground ahead sloped down.
Let me out!
Oh, for God's sake. He started banging on the car window, screaming.
Help! Let me out! Help!
Well, she wasn't going to die with that racket going on. Besides, any second now, he'd realise he could wrap his hands around her throat and they'd be going nowhere. She released the door lock. In a split second, the boy was out of the car, running towards the cliff path. She watched until he vanished, until all, once more, was silent and still on the clifftop. Where were we? She asked her dead companion. The woman beside her had no answer to give. Ready to face the enemy? Still no answer. And so she sat, waiting for the pain to wash over her again,
to give her the reason she needed to press one foot down and lift the other. It didn't come. She thought about the boy, racing back towards Eastbourne, cursing his bad luck at running into a psycho seconds before he ended everything. She'd saved a life tonight. Damn it, it felt good. I wish I could have saved you, she said to the woman beside her. How about I save you instead? Replied her dead friend. And then, for no reason she could think of, she turned to the back seat, where the boy had been sitting minutes earlier. On the pale grey leather lay the bundle of documents she'd brought from the South London squat where the two of them had been living. No passports or driving licences. Neither girl had ever applied for either. No birth certificates, because they'd been lost in officialdom years earlier. A card with a national insurance number. A library ticket. A student ID card. Very little to show for two teenage lives, one of which was most definitely over. The question was, which one? Entirely unexpectedly, from complete despair, a chance had arisen, and facing her now, the possibility of a new start. A leaving behind of the pain and the loss and the hopelessness. She'd be a fool not to take it. She had never been a fool. Switching off the engine, she acted quickly, removing from the car any paperwork that might identify its last occupants, and wiping clean the steering wheel and all the internal surfaces she could reach. Releasing her friend's seatbelt, she slid her hands beneath the dead woman's body and pulled her across the middle of the car and into the driver's seat. Then she put the car into neutral and released the handbrake. For a second, it didn't move, and so she gripped the edge of the open window, braced her feet against the rocky ground, and pushed. Movement. She pushed again, and the car rolled forward. With one last look at her dead friend, she ran round to the back of the vehicle, where she could put more muscle into the task. She pushed hard, the bumpy ground giving her feet purchase. The car picked up speed, veered a little to the left, and found a steeper slope. It rolled on, and she no longer needed to push. She stood back and watched as the car gathered pace until the front tyres reached the edge. For a split second it paused, and she thought perhaps it wouldn't work, but then the front of the vehicle dipped, a scraping of metal over rock pierced the silence, and the car upended, presenting its undercarriage to the night. A second later, it was gone. It seemed to take a very long time before the crash sounded. She didn't look. She had no need to see the devastation below. Instead, she left the heathland and began the long walk back to London. After a year or so, she applied, successfully, to join the Metropolitan Police. Part 1. Chapter 1. 12 years later, more or less to the day. Since she joined the Metropolitan Police's Marine Unit, Constable, soon to be Sergeant, fingers crossed, Lacey Flint, had grown used to being surprised by the river. Huge and magnificent, at times both heartbreakingly beautiful and quietly terrifying, it had become a constant presence in her life. The smell of it never left her, nor did the sound. Its endless beat formed the rhythm of her life now. She lived on it, worked on it, played on it. She loved it with a passion shown to very few things in her life and practically no people. Almost none. There was one, far away, whom she always had loved and always would. And another,
the other. But the Thames, though, the Thames was like home, nurturing, comforting, safe. At the same time, a wild country of infinite adventures. She knew it would never be her friend. No one with a brain took the Thames for granted, especially the stretch that flowed through London, the tidal part, the dangerous part. In little over a year with the Marine Unit, Lacey Flint had found dead women wrapped in shrouds and half-drowned living ones, fleeing dangers unspeakable in far-off lands. She'd found Iron Age weapons, bones of prehistoric animals, and messages in bottles that turned out to be suicide notes. She'd fished out smugglers' hordes and drunken pirates celebrating stag parties. She'd even encountered a mermaid. She felt, at times, as though she'd seen everything the river could throw at her. And so, the inflatable unicorn, lying grubby and forlorn on the foreshore, didn't alarm her. It should have done, but even Lacey Flint could make the wrong call on occasions. September, the best time of year, full of golden light and silvery mist, when the river calms for a while, as most of the troublesome tourists go home, and the drinkers perch less frequently on its walls. Lacey loved September. After all, she'd been born in the month. Well, sort of. She'd left her home, a vintage sailing yacht moored permanently in Deptford Creek, a little over 40 minutes ago, on her way, not to work, because her shift wasn't due to start till afternoon, but to a social event. For the longest time, Lacey Flint had eschewed friends, because friends had a habit of being curious, asking questions, unearthing secrets that should never see the light of day. But she'd learned, occasionally to her cost, more often to her benefit, that no matter how well you hid yourself from life, life, pesky business that it was, had a way of tracking you down. And so now, she had friends, and two of them had arranged to meet her for a late breakfast at a sweet little place, their words not hers, off Tower Bridge. It wouldn't usually take 40 minutes to get from Deptford Creek to Tower Bridge, even with London traffic, but Lacey Flint was travelling by river. Of course she was. A white one-woman kayak flew across the water, even with a strong tide against her. Heading out for nearly 3 hours now, the river was reaching peak flow, something around 4 knots, taking everything without sufficient power out with it, to the estuary and ultimately the North Sea. She kept close to the north bank, because keeping right or starboard was a Port of London Authority rule, and staying in the shallows kept her out of the fiercer reaches of the tidal flow. The dredges, barges and catamarans in the central channel couldn't be relied upon to spot a lonely kayak, or to avoid it if they did see it. It really was better to keep to the edges when out on the river. Lacey knew the river well, and since moving to Deptford Creek, she'd become exceptionally strong, kayaking most days, even swimming. Although swimming in the tidal Thames was a bylaw offence and, according to her boss, Superintendent David Cook, punishable by immediate dismissal if she was caught doing it again, and he meant it this time, Lacey. Going back after breakfast would be a doddle. The tide would be on her side, and she'd zip along, using the paddle only for steerage. 5 minutes before the time she'd arranged to meet her friends, she approached St. Catherine Docks. A stone's throw upriver, Tower Bridge soared high and pretentious in its Victorian grandeur, and there seemed to be two people among the numerous pedestrians on it who were watching her. Actually, there were three, but she only saw two. One of the two, the taller, waved, and Lacey risked missing a stroke to waddle the paddle back. The smaller, darker-haired woman kept her arms wrapped around her chest.
a chest that seemed bigger, lumpier than usual. But then Lacey's attention was dragged from her friends by something incongruous near the pierhead. A pool inflatable sat on the narrow strip of foreshore between the river wall and the water. The kind of floating toy that children played with in swimming pools. It was white, with rainbow markings, about a metre and a half tall at its head by about the same distance long, and at the very back of her mind, she heard the faintest whisper that a pool inflatable had no business on one of the most dangerous rivers in the world. Chapter 2. Helen spotted Lacey first, naturally, because Helen had never lost her police officer's instinct to look around at all times, take stock, spot the trouble before the trouble itself even knew it was brewing. Dana had been able to do that once. Crossing the bridge made Dana nervous these days, because what if it started moving while she was still trying to make her way to the other side and she couldn't get off? It had never happened to her knowledge, not in over 100 years, but still. Helen, oblivious to the possibility of a bridge-related disaster, was looking downriver. "The woman's nuts," Helen said, meaning Lacey, of course, in a white boat that looked as though a determined wash might overturn it. Dana didn't argue. She'd concluded some time back that Lacey Flint was nuts. Since the night they'd met, almost exactly 2 years ago, when Lacey, covered in a dying woman's blood, had shown remarkable presence of mind at an especially gruesome crime scene, Dana had lost count of the number of times she'd been horrified by the younger woman's recklessness. On the other hand, she was one of the bravest people Dana knew, and her instincts verged on brilliant. Inigo squirmed against Dana's chest, and her hand went automatically to his head to soothe him. She loved carrying him in the papoose, strapped snugly against her body. It was the closest she could get to having him safely back inside her again, where no one could touch him, or hurt him, or take him from her. Dana hadn't told anyone, not even Helen, that she'd never really known fear until her son was born, but that now it consumed her life. Fear of an unusual cry or whimper, fear of too long a stillness in the night, of a temperature, a rash, of taking her eyes off him for the split second it took for him to vanish. The only time she felt safe was when the three of them were tucked up in the bedroom, Inigo in the crib by her side of the bed, and no, he might be nearly 6 months old, but he wasn't ready for his own room yet. Dana's world had become full of fear, and yet, in a matter of days, she'd be leaving him, for hours at a time, in the Southwark nursery they'd just visited on the South Bank, so that she could return to work. Dana Tullock was a detective inspector with the Metropolitan Police, or at least she had been until she became a mother. She felt relief flooding through her as they left the bridge and walked the short distance to their rendezvous point. The cafe, also a busy delicatessen, was Sicilian, and the owner, who didn't normally allow tables to be reserved, always made an exception in the case of 2 senior police officers. Busy packing truffle oil and dried mushrooms into a paper bag for a waiting customer, he greeted Dana and Helen with a tight-lipped smile and indicated a table by the far wall. Back aching, Dana released Inigo from the papoose, sitting him on her lap. Her arms would remain pinned to her side for the remainder of their visit to stop him tumbling. But Innie was an active, impatient baby who hated being still, even worse, restrained. "Here she comes," said Helen, and Dana turned to see a slim, fair-haired young woman in sports clothes in the street outside. It was the first time the two of them had seen Lacey since June, when she'd been co-opted by their mutual friend Mark Joesbury into a tricky undercover operation in the Northwest. Technically, the op had been a success, and some very dangerous men were awaiting trial. On the other hand, a young woman had died. No decent officer got over something like that easily. Mark hadn't, and it was unlikely Lacey had either. The doorbell sounded, and Lacey pulled her face into a smile that, to Dana's eyes, looked forced. She'd certainly taken some persuading to meet them this morning.
Good Lord, he's huge!
Lacey's eyes stayed on the baby as she kissed Helen and smiled at Dana. How was the nursery?
At least 2 degrees too warm, and they need some soft furnishings to soak up the noise, Dana replied. There are big kids running around near the baby's cots, and I'm not convinced the food they serve is as organic as they claim.
Absolutely fine, Helen said. Lovely staff and very happy kids. It's the best rated in South London, and it starts on Monday morning. Looking forward to it, aren't you, Rugrat?
Helen pulled a freakishly distorted face at Inigo, who squealed and flapped his hands in the air.
Babies need social interaction, Helen added. So do their mothers. Failing that, they need to get back to work.
He's so happy. Lacey was still smiling at Inigo. I don't think I've heard him cry yet.
That's because Dana never puts him down, Helen said.
Ask her if you can hold him. Go on, give it a try. She'll find some excuse not to let you.
Of course Lacey can hold Innie, Dana snapped, but she's just kayaked from Deptford and she probably wants to get her breath back.
Lacey took her seat.
Feels like ages, Helen began. We haven't seen you since you got back from Cumbria.
Let it never be said that Helen didn't tackle difficult subjects head on.
Glad to be back on the river, Helen pressed on, or has Cumbria changed your mind about staying in uniform?
18 months ago, on the brink of leaving the police for good, Lacey had requested redeployment, a move normally forced upon officers who'd fallen from favour. Lacey, on the contrary, had turned her back on a promising career in CID and returned to uniform service as part of the Marine unit.
There's a lot to be said for the quiet life, Lacey smiled, to show she was half-joking.
The Thames was one of the busiest urban waterways in the world, a well-used route for both people and drug smuggling, and it had a high body count.
Dana has something to ask you, Helen said.
Damn it, she'd wanted to wait.
What?
Lacey looked curious, just a tiny bit wary.
She'd planned to sound out how Lacey was feeling, maybe even put the conversation off for another day.
You know Neil's been acting DI while I've been on maternity leave, Dana began. Neil Anderson was Dana's deputy in Lewisham's major incident team, an officer Lacey had worked with several times. His promotion is likely to be confirmed in the next few weeks, and he'll soon move on, Dana continued. The team will be rejigged, and there'll be a vacancy. I've sounded out the powers that be, and if you were interested in moving back to CID, your application would be looked on favourably.
Lacey's eyes were clouding over. Well, she couldn't say she hadn't been warned.
Helen, Mark, even Dave Cook, Lacey's boss at the Marine unit, had all told her that Lacey was fine where she was, thank you very much. Intent on protecting a young woman they all cared about, they'd argued that Lacey had been involved in too many dangerous and difficult cases, had faced more death and darkness in her fledgling career than most coppers saw their entire service. Dana couldn't argue, but the waste of talent drove her nuts. Lacey had the makings of a great detective.
I can think about it, Lacey said, her eyes on the table. Thank you.
Ignoring the told-you-so look on Helen's face, Dana said, There was one thing, though. The food arrived before Dana could finish. Oatmeal with berries for her, a croissant for Lacey, and an extravagant plate of poached eggs, hollandaise sauce and pancetta on ciabatta bread for Helen, who never seemed to gain an ounce, no matter what she ate. Inigo, who'd been showing an interest in real food recently, reached for his mother's bowl. Propping him on one arm, Dana tried it. Far too hot and probably salted, she'd palm him off with a raspberry.
dating anyone? Helen asked Lacey, which was another topic best avoided in Dana's mind. Lacey's on-off, will-they-won't-they relationship with Mark Joesbury seemed to have stalled completely.
What about that colleague of yours? You know, the one who climbs like a monkey. What do they call him? Batman?
Mark was keeping tight-lipped about it too. That said, Mark was avoiding Dana and Helen almost as much as Lacey had been, probably trying to avoid exactly these questions.
Spider-Man, Lacey answered, a.k.a. Finn Turner. And no, he's too much of a player for my taste.
Seen anything of the new boss of SCD-10?
Helen meant Mark, recently promoted on the back of the Cumbria case. Honestly, did the woman know the meaning of the word tact?
Out on the foreshore, fewer than 200 metres away, a man was blowing more air into the plastic pool inflatable.
Chapter 3.
There was something you wanted to ask me, Lacey reminded Dana as they got up to leave. Bill paid, baby paraphernalia gathered into Helen's backpack, Inigo safely in his papoose. The three women said their goodbyes to the cafe owner and stepped out onto the embankment. The day had grown brighter, clouds clearing to leave a cornflower blue sky, but a fresher breeze was coming off the water.
We can do it some other time, Dana replied.
The others had been right. Lacey wasn't ready for a return to CID. Her refusal to talk about Cumbria, her evasive replies when questioned about Mark, her reluctance to talk about herself on any level, all led to the same conclusion. Lacey wasn't ready.
No, you can't, Helen argued. Get it over with or this'll drag on.
Dana gave a very audible sigh.
It's just, people really are very keen to get you back into CID, Lacey. They know what an asset you'd be, but damn, Helen, this really wasn't the time. There is some, I won't say concern exactly, just a bit of, well, you could call it disquiet. And the extent to which you can put minds at rest, it could smooth things over very helpfully.
Helen breathed out loudly through her nose.
Spit it out, Lacey said, her face a picture of patient amusement.
Questions are being asked about your monthly visits to Durham Prison, Dana said in a rush. I understand you and Victoria Llewellyn have a history, and everyone knows you were instrumental in her arrest, and there's no question that you've acted improperly at any time. The hearing made that clear. It's just, it doesn't look good.
Lacey's face had closed down. Not meeting Dana's eyes, she pulled out her phone.
Look, I've got to go. I'm going to miss the tide. Let's do this some other time. Good to see you both.
And that was that. A quick kiss on both their cheeks, a lingering one on the top of Inigo's head, and Lacey had left them, striding off towards Tower Bridge Quay.
Told you so, said Helen.
Chapter 4. Out of sight of Dana and Helen, Lacey allowed her footsteps to slow. She'd always known this would happen. She'd been lucky, in a way, not to have faced it before now. Her regular visits to one of the most notorious serial killers the UK had ever known had been bound, sooner or later, to become an issue. More questions would come, Lacey knew, from people who were not her friends, until her situation became abundantly clear. Either she ceased her monthly visits to Durham Prison, or she waved goodbye to any chance of promotion. Even her job might be at stake. A passenger ferry was pulling away from the pier, creating a sparkling silver fan in its wake, as Lacey made her way towards the water. Ahead on the ramp, two gulls fought over the remains of a mitten crab, and a gold foil balloon, wishing someone a happy 21st birthday, struggled to be free from where it had snagged on the bridge. Lacey, lost in thought, saw none of it. Nearly 2 years after her arrest,
Few long-term prisoners attracted a fraction of the public and media interest, as did the woman known to the world as Victoria Llewellyn. Partly, her notoriety could be explained by the fact that she was young and beautiful, equally by the considerable public sympathy her case had generated. Because, aged just 16, Victoria and her 14-year-old sister Kathy had been gang-raped in a Cardiff park by 5 English public schoolboys. The boys' parents had thrown all their wealth and influence at the allegation, ensuring no charges were ever brought. The lives of the two sisters, dysfunctional to begin with, had fallen apart. The story the world believed was that the younger, Kathy, had gone completely off the rails, running away from home, living rough on the streets of London, only to meet a tragic death in a riverboat accident some years later. Then, learning of her sister's death, Victoria had embarked on a brutal plan of revenge. Determined to destroy the boys who'd raped her, to ruin their lives, as her own had been, she'd focused her fury on their mothers. One by one, horribly and publicly, she'd abducted and murdered the 4 middle-aged women. With every intention of claiming one last victim, she'd been tracked down and arrested by Lacey. The world, or at least the part of it that was the Metropolitan Police, believed that Lacey Flint and Victoria Llewellyn were old friends, that they'd met and grown close when Victoria had been searching for her sister, and when Lacey too had been living on the streets. They believed that a long-standing loyalty drove her monthly visits to Durham. What the world believed wasn't true, of course. The real truth was a secret that could never see the light of day. Lacey could never tell the world who the woman in Durham prison really was, any more than she could cut her out of her life. It was lucky, then, that she had no intention of returning to CID, that she could cheerfully live out her days with the Met being nothing more than a humble river constable. She could even leave the police if she had to, because the woman, known mistakenly to the world as Victoria Llewellyn, was as essential to Lacey as breathing. Chapter 5. "Okay," Helen said, in that drawn-out, nervous tone people use when what they really mean is that something is very far from okay. The two women were a third of the way up Tower Bridge steps, and for some reason, Helen had glanced down, possibly to watch Lacey paddle away. "What?" Instinctively, Dana's hands wrapped around Inigo's papoose. Helen didn't reply, and so Dana followed her line of sight. Down on the embankment, 2 people pushing prams, a man and a woman, had stopped to chat, and 2 other men, with scarves around their faces, were approaching them fast. As they reached the woman's pram, and one of them leaned into it, Helen started to run back down the steps. From her vantage point, Dana watched in horror as one man scooped the woman's baby, a girl dressed in pink, out of her pram and ran with her towards Tower Bridge Quay. A baby was being abducted right before their eyes. Reaching the bottom of the steps, Helen set off at a sprint, but the second man had followed the first, and both of them were thundering down the pier's access ramp. Passers-by who'd witnessed the incident were yelling. One set off after the 2 men. The mother began to scream. The man she'd been chatting with, who also had a pram, started yelling that they needed help. Could they get some help, and was anyone calling the police? Dana could think of nothing but the child in her arms. Keeping him safe, that was her job now. Her only job. "Dana!" Helen was yelling back at her. "Call it in!" As Helen disappeared down the ramp, Dana struggled to get her phone from her pocket. All the numbers she'd carried in her head for years, she'd always had such a good memory for numbers, had deserted her. So she pressed the 9 key 3 times and hoped it still worked. The bereft mother, hysterical now, was leaning over the embankment wall, screaming at the people below. People Dana couldn't see, but who must include the two abductors, several innocent bystanders, Helen, who'd run straight into danger without thinking, because that's what she did, and Lacey Flint, of course, who'd be down on the foreshore by now, and who attracted trouble like purple flowers drew the bees. Dana's emergency call was answered, and she found the words she needed. Abduction in process on the north embankment, a few yards south of Tower Bridge. Young infant snatched from its mother, heading down Tower Bridge Quay to the river. Urgent assistance needed. She could speak, but she couldn't move. In the old days, she'd have been right behind Helen. Dana Tullock, Detective Inspector with Lewisham MIT, off duty. Picking up on her distress, Inigo started to whimper. Two males, white, I think, faces covered. They must still be on the pier, unless they've got into the water somehow. I can't quite see. If she got closer, she'd have a better view. You need to alert the marine unit. They must be planning to escape via the river. Still, she felt herself frozen on the spot, not knowing whether to stay put, where she and her baby were safe, or get into the thick of it, secure the scene, comfort the howling mother, do her job. And then the decision was taken from her, because the other male in the grim tableau, the dad who'd been left behind, lifted his own pram and hurled it over the embankment wall. It vanished, plummeting to the river far below. Chapter 6. Detective Chief Inspector Mark Joesbury was at his desk, which always puts him in a bad mood. Regularly and frequently, he told himself he'd been promoted to the level of his incompetence, and so dark was his mood these days that he genuinely believed it. In his younger days, in junior roles, he'd excelled. In uniform, he'd found a rapport with the communities he policed that brought an inflow of information most coppers could only dream of. Promoted rapidly to detective, his solve rate had been unparalleled, and his potential for undercover work spotted. As a covert operative in the Met's SCD-10, his unconventional approach had brought him to the brink of dismissal more than once, but he'd always got the job done. He'd led some of the most dangerous and high-profile operations in the country, culminating in saving the lives of the family of the President of the United States. His bosses had tried to move him then, arguing that he was on the verge of having a public profile, the kiss of death to an undercover operator. But he'd argued for one last job. One last job in which he'd nearly lost the woman he loved, not for the first time, and had killed a man for the first time. And that was that. A desk job for DCI Joesbury. From now on, he'd be the one planning the ops, sending the young Turks into the field, putting other men and women at risk. From now on, all the blood would be on his hands, because the buck stopped with him. And he really wasn't very good at it. Sir, one of his new team was leaning into his office. A graduate of Cambridge University's computer science program, a specialist in online finance and fraud, 28-year-old Theo Cox had worked in the city for a while before joining the Met as a civilian consultant. His first job, after training, had been an assignment to Joesbury's team. Theo dressed well for a copper, and Joesbury had a feeling his suit that morning was a silk mix, if not pure silk, and almost certainly made to measure. He invariably wore shirts and ties in bright shades of blue or lilac to bring out the colour of his long, deep-set eyes. His hair was Scandinavian blonde, perfectly cut. Grateful for the interruption, Joesbury closed the report he'd been scanning. Theo, what can I do for you? With the unshakable self-confidence of the public school, top university background, Theo was already in the room. You said we had to let you know immediately if anything out of the ordinary happened around Tower Bridge? Theo was monitoring noise, online activity in and around the capital, watching for the errant flow, the tick, the beginning of a pattern, anything that might indicate a problem brewing.
What have you got? The boy's hands were empty. It was like this lot had never heard of paperwork. Came in seconds ago. The system flagged it up. I've sent it to you. Joesbury opened his inbox. A few lines of text, an internet alert. Theo barely gave him a chance to take it in. Abduction of an infant on the embankment south of Tower Bridge. Off-duty police officer in attendance. Uniform on their way. Dana, Joesbury said, seeing the name of his best friend and godmother to his son on the screen. He glanced up. It's ongoing. Theo gave a sharp, excited nod. Looks that way. Tower Bridge was a little over a mile down the embankment from Scotland Yard. Joesbury was on his feet. Get your coat.
Chapter 7. The Thames has an impressive tidal reach, boasting a range of up to 7 metres between some high and low tides. Whilst not remarkable in absolute terms, the 7 with 15 metres might sneer. 7 metres means a river that runs high against the embankment walls at the start of the day can reveal sizeable areas of foreshore 6 hours later. When Lacey Flint got back to Tower Bridge Quay on that mid-September morning, the tide had been going out for 3 hours and a narrow strip of grey beach had appeared, spattered with dirty rocks and damp rubbish. The river wall, festooned with ancient mooring chains, stretched 15 metres high. Its upper parts, a dirt-blackened stone, its lower reaches, dripping with emerald weed. Lacey made for the inside of the pier, where she'd left her kayak. The pier owners were relaxed about her mooring up. Most people who work on the river prefer to stay on the right side of the marine unit, and Lacey, in her time with the division, had become popular with the law-abiding members of the river community. Less so with the less than. The pool inflatable she'd noticed earlier was still there, a few yards further down the foreshore, held now on a thin stretch of rope by a man in dark running clothes. Lacey's first instinct was relief that it wasn't in the hands of kids, a feeling that lasted less than a second. She'd barely settled herself in the kayak when a commotion broke out on the embankment above her head. Screams rang through the routine hum of London, and a woman, Lacey thought she recognised Helen's voice, was shouting. A car horn sounded, footsteps running. The suspended walkway that led from embankment to pier, designed for careful, slow passage, began to bounce and judder as heavy footsteps ran down it. 2 men were heading her way. Responding instinctively, Lacey scrambled out of the kayak and pulled out her phone as the first runner, his face half covered by a scarf, made eye contact and checked his speed. Light eyes, a white male, young, thin, clutching something to his chest. A third man appeared on the walkway, older, dark-skinned, in workman's clothes, giving chase.
Stop them!
He yelled as he set off down. The first 2 men picked up speed. Then Helen too appeared. The first man reached the pier and, for the love of God, that was a baby in his arms. He leaped over the pier's railing, landed on the foreshore and raced past her.
Lacey, it's a baby!
Yelled Helen, unnecessarily. The baby, aware on some level that its safe, orderly world had been turned upside down, was yelling its head off. Lacey gave chase, knowing her chances were slim. She had neither uniform nor warrant card, no radio for instant access to Wapping Control, no colleagues to back her up. She was just a girl, facing 3 blokes, intent on something unspeakable. As she left the pier, she sank into grey mud and could only watch in horror as the 3 men lowered the baby onto the inflatable and pushed it out across the water. She'd known there was something wrong about that inflatable. Why hadn't she acted earlier? Then the 3 men were coming at her, like the front row in a rugby team. The first struck out with his right fist. The blow caught the side of her head and knocked her off balance. The second yelled something she didn't catch. She almost fell,
taking several drunken paces to get her balance back as the men's squelching footsteps receded. She didn't so much as turn to watch them flee. The baby. Lacey ran to the water's edge. The inflatable's line. There was a chance she could catch it. But the greedy river had claimed its last sacrifice, and the toy, a unicorn she saw now, white with rainbow markings, was nearly 20 metres downriver. A hand touched her shoulder. "How deep?" Helen said. "Can I wade out?" Lacey spun away. "No chance. Get on to Wapping. They've got minutes to cut it off." Minutes at most. The outgoing tide typically travelled at 4 knots, and Wapping Police Station, where the Marine Unit were based, wasn't far downriver. As Lacey climbed once more over the pier's railing, she saw that the fourth man, Asian, in work clothes, was running along the foreshore after the three men, but he was older, slower, and they had a head start. She heard Helen on the phone, giving her name and police rank, demanding to be put through to Wapping Station, and knew she had to leave all that behind. The river, the baby, that was all she could think about now. Police officers are trained to see, to notice, and the Marine Unit officers could not be on the river without constantly taking in their surroundings. Lacey Flint was no different. If anything, she was better at it than most. There had been a targa, one of the boats the unit used to patrol the river, tied up at the pier at Wapping Police Station, as she'd paddled past earlier, and 2 high-speed rigid inflatable boats, or ribs. Her colleagues could be on the river in minutes. "I can catch it," she yelled back at Helen as she jumped into her kayak. "Get the river cleared of traffic and get the guys at Wapping out on the..." As the tide took her, she saw Helen turn and gasp. A baby's pram had appeared, balanced on top of the embankment wall. It hovered and then fell, landing heavily on the sand 15 metres below. Chapter 8. At the foot of Tower Bridge steps, a crowd had gathered. Somewhere in the distance, a siren was drawing closer. The man who'd thrown the pram was on the other side of the busy road, heading north towards the city, and Dana had to let him go. Another man, in a suit, carrying a copy of the Financial Times, broke away from the group and made for the pier. With one hand firmly on Inigo's head, Dana ran towards him. "Sir." He turned at the head of the ramp. "Sir, I'm an off-duty police officer. Uniformed police are on their way. Until they arrive, can you please stay here and stop anyone going down to the river?" The man gestured towards the water. "He threw a baby." He swallowed. "That pram he threw. There was a baby in it. He threw a baby over the wall." "I know that, sir. My colleague is down there, and I'm going myself. It's a crime scene now, and we need to secure it. Can you help us, please, for a few minutes?" He looked uncertain, then relieved. He nodded his agreement, and so she slipped past him. Still holding tight to Inigo's head, Dana ran down the ramp. 3 people came into view. Helen, talking into the phone, her eyes fixed on the upturned buggy. Her partner, the bravest human she knew, fazed by nothing, looked about to be sick. The man who'd chased the abductors was leaning against the pier rail, out of breath. He too was staring in horror at the pram, half hidden by mud. "Babies," he muttered, as Dana drew close. "Who does this to babies?" And Lacey, back in her kayak, paddling furiously away from the pier. No sign of the first baby, or the 2 men who'd abducted it. "Yes, Constable Lacey Flint is in pursuit," Helen was saying. "She's in a kayak. She's about..." Dana watched Helen drag her eyes towards the river. "About 50 metres downstream of Tower Bridge. I can't see the inflatable. Yes, white, about 1.5 metres at its tallest point. The rainbow markings. A unicorn. We need teams out on the river now." As Dana put her hand on her partner's shoulder, Helen actually jumped, relaxing only when she saw who'd approached. Disconnecting the call, her eyes went quickly to Inigo. "He's fine," Dana said. "What's happening?"
Three men, one waiting down here for the other two. Baby on the river in a very flimsy-looking inflatable. Lacey in hot pursuit. And then that happened. Helen indicated, with a terse nod of her head, the upturned pram. Lacey was already out of sight. She was brave, too. Super fit. More than capable. But how could a baby survive out on the river? And in the meantime, another tragedy. Meters away. We need to look, Dana said. I know. Neither woman moved. Helen said, I don't think I can. Dana unclipped the papoose. Take Innie, she said. Dana's body felt cold as she handed over her son and, as she stepped forward, towards what she instinctively knew would be the worst thing she'd ever seen, she felt as though something essential inside her had gone, as though, if she looked back at Helen, their son would have vanished. As her feet sank into the mud, she found herself doubting she'd ever been a mother. This was her job, though. She had to get herself over there. The mud was deep. Already Dana's shoes were filthy, and that had to be a good thing. The landing would have been soft, but the fall was over 15 metres. Even strapped in, the baby couldn't have escaped serious injury. If anything, the straps would have made matters worse, fixing the tiny body in place as the jolt of landing shook it apart. The poor little thing would have stood a better chance if it hadn't been strapped in. As it was, the most likely result, Dana knew, was that the infant's neck had broken. What kind of father threw his infant child to an almost certain death? No kind of father, she realised. The baby she was about to see had also been abducted in order to be murdered. Two dead babies, because the one on the river couldn't survive. How could such a pretty day have gone so badly wrong? The pram, when she reached it, was one she recognised. A Silver Cross Pioneer in Eton Grey. It retailed at nearly £900 and had been on their shortlist of six. For God's sake, Dana, I cannot look at another pram. Will you make a decision? It was upside down, the grey fabric roof largely hidden in the mud, its wheels still spinning. Dana wasn't sure she could do this either. A murdered baby. It was unthinkable. And yet, if it had to be done, it should be done by a mother. The thought gave Dana a courage of sorts, and taking hold of the aluminium framework, she pulled. The foreshore pulled back. She sensed a presence at her side and realised Helen, with Inigo strapped to her own chest now, had approached. From beneath the fabric came the sound of a baby, a splutter, a wail, then a high-pitched cry. Both women looked at their own child, fast asleep. It's alive! For God's sake, Helen, get it out! It's alive! They reached out together, grasped the pram and pulled. This time, their combined strength drew it from the mud and set it upright. The baby inside, still strapped in, dressed in a blue and white striped suit with a blue cap, seemed entirely unblemished, other than a smattering of mud across its, his, face. The crying continued, and yet the face the two women stared down at was motionless. He, it, was entirely lifeless, and yet not dead. Not a baby at all, but a lifelike baby doll with an internal sound mechanism. Chapter 9. The unicorn had a head start, but Lacey's kayak was designed to move swiftly through water. Considerably more aerodynamic than a circular float, it would catch up quickly, all other things being equal. All other things, though, were not equal. The unicorn had been swept out towards the faster flow of the central channel, where it would be dangerous for Lacey to follow. A fast-moving barge would not be looking out for tiny craft in its path.
one of the passenger ferries, could mow them both down. The distance to Wapping from Tower Bridge was a little over a mile, and the tide would cover a mile in minutes. Technically, there was time for the marine unit to intercept the child, but only if her colleagues were able to get immediately out on the river. Sometimes that couldn't happen. Keys mislaid, boats needing refueling, the right officer temporarily out of the building. Helen's phone call would have alerted the Port of London Authority, which technically had responsibility for safety on the river, but their lifeboat stations weren't close enough. A rogue wave washed over the kayak. Open-mouthed from the effort of paddling, she registered the gritty, oily taste of Thames water as the inflatable, closer now, maybe 50 metres away, bounced on a similar wave. Children's inflatables were designed for swimming pools, not fast urban rivers. The gentlest of waves, the tiniest of washes from a passing boat, would tip it and the baby would sink like a stone. The unicorn didn't tip, but it was spinning on the current. Its circular shape couldn't hold a course in the water, and the lack of keel was sending it in different directions each time the wind caught it. 40 metres away, but the wind was taking it back towards the north bank. There'd be less river traffic closer to the shore, but, conversely, more obstacles that could overturn it.
"Get to the side!"
Without her registering its presence, a motorboat had approached Lacey from behind. Glancing back, she saw the vessel's skipper yelling at her, "Get out of the channel!" There were 4 people on board, one of whom seemed to be filming her on a video camera.
"Move to starboard," she called back. "Stay away from that inflatable."
20 metres now between her and the baby, and they were skimming past the houseboats of the Hermitage riverboat community. Residents were running the length of the boats, keeping pace with the inflatable.
"Baby!" one of them yelled at her. "There's a baby!"
The motorboat, its crew having grasped something of what...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.